Hey everybody, and welcome back to Split Couch Games. I'm Scott.
And I'm Ben.
And today, we're going to be talking about Project Scorpio. Microsoft has released their specs for it and shown off a tech demo to Digital Foundry, and there's a lot to talk about on that. But first, Ben's going to give us an update on his feelings on Mass Effect Andromeda's animations. Yeah. Go, Ben, go.
This is just going to be like a quick little blurb. It's not going to take up that much time at all.
Ben doesn't do anything quick.
Yes, I do. I do everything quick. That's not true. anyways, so basically, you know, now that I've played the game and everything, I did want to state, you know, that I do feel like a lot of the complaints were justified. I still feel like the blame was being misplaced, because I don't think that in a lot of situations they were bad animations as much as it was that the content was set up incorrectly. They did, you know, come out and say like they're planning on fixing everything. They've even already fixed a lot of the eyes and that kind of thing in the game. Like they're starting to roll out patches. And I mean, the eyes specifically almost look as if they were just missing like ambient inclusion on the shaders.
And because, for those of us who don't know what that is,
That's basically going to be a shader that helps differentiate between the lights and the darks. Like it gives things more depth and 3D form without actually like adding to the object. And that may not even be a 100% accurate description, but that's how I understand it.
That's all anyone needs.
Yeah.
I mean, I knew that. I just was making sure that everyone listening knew.
But I mean, like, you can kind of tell that that's what was probably missing with the eyes, because, like, the new eyes kind of have, like, that almost depth between, like, the actual surface of the eye and then the retina that you can see, like, when you actually look at a real human. It has that, and they're a little darker, but they also have more defined highlights and that kind of thing. But anyways, like I said, I feel the complaints were justified, just the anger was misplaced.
Sure. Are you trying to tell me, though, that the anger on the internet is misplaced?
Yes.
Ben, please. Let's not get ridiculous here.
Okay.
Anyway.
Anyways, back to Scorpio.
So, well, hold on. You got to check in with your one blurb. I'm going to check in really briefly with my blurb.
Okay.
The Mariners baseball season is underway, and if anyone can figure out where the Mariners offense is, please return it to Safe Go Field. Thank you.
Nobody cares.
It's so upsetting to me how bad they're playing right now. Anyway, Project Scorpio. They've released their stats their specs for it, and it's very easily the strongest console to ever be created, kind of just how they promised.
Yep.
And you know, they
until
brought
the
digital
next one.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's kind of how technology works. This is the strongest a year later. Oops.
Turns out someone beat us already. Our bad.
But they brought Digital Foundry out, which was the original outlet that broke that the Scorpio probably wasn't going to be able to do true 4K and all that.
Yeah.
There was that big whole thing where it's like, we got these white papers and Scorpio's just not going to be that strong. Well, they've definitely changed their tune. Like, they released a full article, and they really, like, Digital Foundry doesn't really do reviews in the traditional sense. They just kind of, like, present facts.
Yeah.
But you can tell in the way that they wrote this that they're very excited about the console.
Sure.
But just like some highlights here, it's going to have 8 custom x86 cores clocked at 2.3 gigahertz each. The Xbox One has 8 cores at 1.75 gigahertz, and the PS4 Pro has 8 at 2.1 gigahertz, so it's going to be a little bit stronger there.
Yeah.
The biggest thing probably is going to be that there's 12 gigabytes of DDR5 RAM versus the PS4 Pro, which has 8. Important to note on that is that 4 of those is dedicated to running the OS.
How so, are there 4 gigs of RAM dedicated to running the OS? Is that how it is on it's standard running, Xbox?
I don't know off the top of my head. But it's because the way that Digital Foundry said it was basically because it was running at 4K on the
Why
OS
is
as well.
Why is the OS running at 4K?
Because it's got to be pretty. And it's also possibly because of the way that the game DVR is working now.
Okay, that I can see.
Because that the game sense. DVR, which allows you to go back and record clips from previous times, is going to be at 4K and 60 frames a second, which is going to be incredible for montage makers and myself because I hate
you love pretty.
Love pretty, and all my Gears of War clips are going to be in 4K at 60 frames a second.
As opposed to the, like, what, 720, I think, is what it outputs right now?
720 at 30 frames a second.
Yeah.
It looks like shit. You guys can, like, if you guys want to see what that looks like on YouTube, you can check out some of the clips from my Gears of War tutorials.
Yeah. Now, just to make sure I didn't miss anything, like, you had said that, game DVR would let you go back and record clips from previous times. Was that just you fumbling with words and it functions normal? Or
As far as I can tell, it functions the same way.
Okay, so like, it doesn't backlog an hour of gameplay and then you can go back in you're done with a match or something.
No. It's the same thing where it's like you can record 15 seconds, 30 seconds.
Yeah, okay. I just wanted to make sure that I didn't miss any dramatic change with that or something.
They did say that you're going to be able to go frame by frame and you can pull screenshots out. So like you'll be able to actually watch frame by frame footage of yourself at 60 frames a second.
Nice.
Which is amazing because right now you can't even rewind clips anymore.
Yeah, I don't know what the hell that was. That decision was about. Like when they did that, I was like, guys, what are you doing?
Yeah,
because like sometimes the cool moment is at the very end of the clip. Yeah, like come on.
Yeah, it was a weird mistake. And then the last two things that probably mean things to people. Last three things. There's going to be 326 gigabytes per second of memory bandwidth versus the PS4 Pro's 218. Just means that they're going to be able to send information faster.
Yeah,
and the hard drive still it's gonna be a 1 terabyte hard drive, which still baffles me.
Because it's not a 2 or even like a 4.
Yeah, it's like, hey guys, you're gonna have all these 4K assets. Good luck storing them all.
Well, I don't think any of that's actually stored locally. In terms of like game clips and that kind of thing.
No, I meant like. Games are going to be coming in with 4K assets.
Well, I mean, sure, but most games already have a lot of their assets in much higher resolutions than what the console is capable of outputting. I don't think it's going to change that much.
Okay. I mean, it's something that, like, I just kind of want to, like, go into the future and have 2 terabyte internal storage.
I mean, there should be more internal storage. You're not wrong about that. I'm just saying that I don't see game size changing a whole lot, and you know, the 4K aspect of it aside, I think that's primarily just because Microsoft is, at least for now, still holding to the all Scorpio games must also work on the original Xbox. And I honestly think that's going to be the biggest downfall of it, because if a developer decide that they want to take advantage of the Scorpio's extra power, there's really only going to be so much extra they can do, you know?
Yeah.
Like, they might be able to have more particle effects, render at a higher resolution or something like that, but they won't be able to do anything super amazingly different as far as, like, gameplay engine-wise goes.
Yeah.
You know, they wouldn't be able to have a more realistic physics engine because the older, you know, original Xbox One can't handle it.
Yeah.
And I mean, I honestly, in regards to all that, I would not be surprised if in a year or two, Microsoft was like, you know what? Scorpio exclusive games are okay.
Yeah,
and then like Scorpio just kind of becomes like the new generation in like this kind of nonchalant sort of way.
Yeah, I don't think people would enjoy that very much. I don't think it's gonna be a year. I think it might be like 2 or 3 years, at least. But
well, I mean, you have to keep in mind that like at this point, the Xbox One and the PS4 have been out for like what, 4 years, five by the time Scorpio comes out.
Yeah. And well, yeah, I just, I mean,
that's
like,
a standard console generation.
Yeah, I just, I don't think that they can do that without pissing off people. Like, I think they have to give, like, a little bit more time to the people to kind of hold to that promise. Because, of course, like, eventually Xbox One's going to become obsolete, just like, you know, phones become obsolete and all that. Nothing, like, anyone who's expecting the Xbox One to survive too much longer is being kind of ridiculous. But what I kind of think is going to happen is that as... Because Microsoft's taken a lot of flack for their lack of good exclusives, I kind of feel that what they're going to try to do is bring more exclusives to Scorpio.
Sure. So that,
and like being like, here's incentives to actually develop 4K games for the Scorpio as opposed to like dabbling with it, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And I feel like that would be a smart strategy for them.
Sure. But I mean, I don't know. I still think, like I said, that, you know, in a year or two, I wouldn't be surprised if they were like, you know, Scorpio exclusive games are okay and everything, just because it seems silly to sit there and be like, you know, oh, you know, iPhone 7 is like this great thing, but if you make anything for it, it still has to work on original iPhone.
I mean, it's like... Most PC games do that too, though, where they have to...
I mean, but most PC games still have minimum requirements.
Sure.
And but those minimum requirements aren't fixed. The minimum requirements are up to the developer.
Yeah. I mean, I think that you're able to develop for both easier than you think, I would imagine. Like, I would imagine that, like, it's the same... It's the same architecture, so it's like it's all one code base. It's just you're just managing the assets at that point, which is like not easy, but it's doable.
Yeah.
So I think it's going to last a little bit longer than you think, but not much longer, because like you said, it is already out for 4.5 years at this point.
Yeah.
And yeah.
I don't know. I mean, it'll be interesting for sure. I don't know what... I mean, obviously, nobody knows really how much Scorpio is going to cost right now.
I'm guessing $600.
Yeah, I mean, the general consensus seems to be around, like, $600. There are some analysts that are saying, you know, $650 or $700, maybe even more. But that would literally be product suicide, if you ask me. If they go over the $600 mark, nobody's going to buy it.
Yeah,
I know that they've kind of been marketing this as like a thing for like the hardcore gamers and that kind of thing. But
hardcore console gamers don't want to spend that much.
Yeah. And I mean, I feel like that's also marketing something to like hardcore PC gamers. Yeah. Like, hardcore anything is going to be a very small subset of people, so you can't rely on that being your sole source of income. You have to make it appealing and affordable for the mass market, otherwise, simply the R&D for that product is going to completely outweigh any profit you might make by selling the, you know, niche amount that you might sell.
Yeah, I mean,
I think the No was saying that they heard it was going to be around like 500 or 550, like as a rumor. But
yeah, anyone can say anything. I don't know. I would be surprised if it was more than 600, just because I think they understand that no one wants to spend that much. I feel like this E3 is going to be super important for Microsoft. They have to show us the console, be like, hey, look, it's so beautiful. And then they have to be like, here are all the games that are coming to Microsoft exclusively. Or, like, at least have, like, some sort of exclusive deals.
Yeah.
Whatever the case may be. because, like, no one's excited about the games on the Xbox as it is. No one's going to be, and if that continues, no one's going to be excited about playing prettier games on, like, that they don't care about.
Yeah.
So the biggest thing is that they need to, and I assume that at this point that they have a strategy set up to, like, really just wow us at E3 and be like, this is everything that we're bringing.
Yeah.
You want more Gears of War? You're getting more Gears of War. And I'll be like, I'm getting a Scorpio. But the other thing with the Scorpio is, in order to take advantage of it, you have to have a 4K TV. And
I mean, yes and no.
Well, yeah.
Because...
to take full advantage of it, you have to.
Yeah, to take full advantage of it, you do need to have a 4K TV. But I personally don't like it when people are like, oh, well, you have to have a 4K TV to take advantage of it. Sure. That's just wrong.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, that's like saying, oh, well, you know, you can't play Xbox One games if you don't have a 1080p TV, because it's not worth it, you know?
Yeah. I mean, yeah, you're not wrong. I misspoke. But
yeah,
I wouldn't mind having a 4K help, TV.
But I mean, even if you had just like a standard, 1080, but it has HDR enabled, that'll make the games look a million times better right there. So,
yeah. Speaking of UHD, the last thing that we just didn't get to because you launched into your thing, we don't even have to really talk about it, but I do want to mention that it also is coming with a 4K Blu-ray player, which the PS4 Pro does not have.
Yeah, so 4K if that's UHD. Something you care about, then...
Yeah, like if you're a movie buff, that's going to be good for you.
Yeah, and that still kind of baffles me that Sony didn't do that. I mean, I get it because I can only imagine that it would increase price and...
Yeah, I think Sony definitely HD tried movies. To... Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Ultra HD movies are also just kind of, like, not prevalent right now. So, I understand why, and I understand that, like, Sony kind of went more of, like, the small upgrade route rather than what Microsoft is doing, which is, like, this is basically a new console generation, just without calling it a new console generation. Yeah.
I feel like Sony is almost positioning themselves to undercut Microsoft in like 2 years. Because they're like, yeah, well, I mean, we released the PS4 Pro and it's okay. It's good. We got out before the Scorpio. That's great. And, oh, look, the Scorpio's out. All right, 2 years, we're going to release something better than the Scorpio. Like, I almost feel like that's kind of what they're doing.
Yeah, but I mean, at that point, you're going to have the same issue that... you have right now with the Scorpio versus the PS4 Pro, which is where this, you know, people are gonna like be looking at the two and be like, well, PS4 Pro is now, you know, $100 cheaper, maybe $200.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just gonna get that because most people don't really care about hardware specs. They just care about the marketing hype and they're like, oh, it's better.
Yeah.
Here's my money. So.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, it's definitely interesting. It's a exciting time.
Yeah.
To be a console gamer, because there's just so much. There's a lot of innovation coming, I think. Before it's like it was super. Well, okay, not a lot, but like.
Well, I mean, more than we've had in the past. I was just going to say, not necessarily innovation, but change. There's a lot of change.
Well, I mean, I was also including the Switch in there. I feel like the Switch is decently innovative.
Yeah.
But like, anyway, like it's just there's change and there's new, like, just new stuff to play with, and console manufacturers are pushing each other more as opposed to sitting and being like, all right, well, here's our console for 10 years, good luck. They're actually like kind of it's almost like alternating years of production, and like upping the, which is only good for us, I think. Like, if you buy a console, you, like, 3 years from now you can get another console if you want.
I don't know.
All comes down to the games. And like you said, the marketing hype.
Yeah, it really does. And I feel, I don't know. I mean, when it comes to kind of like what you were saying, where you're expecting Sony to try and undercut them, whether it's with a PS4 Double Pro or, you know, like a PS5 or something like that, I wouldn't honestly be surprised if this was... kind of like what I was saying before, if this was like Microsoft's subtle way of like almost getting rid of console generations. Where instead of like doing a, you know, oh, we have a brand new operating system and, you know, brand new architecture that you have to work around, they just kind of keep existing architecture and like upgrade it as they go and that kind of thing. And then like every other generation has to be backwards compatible with the previous. So it's like in 3 or 4 years, maybe we get a, you know, a Scorpio 2 or whatever that is only backwards compatible with games that were doable on Scorpio. I don't know.
Yeah, no, I see what you're saying. So like eventually, like two consoles later or earlier are obsolete or whatever.
Yeah.
So similar almost, to how iPhones and,
Android kind devices of like work. How iPhones and that kind of thing are handled, and also just sort of how PC gaming works to an extent. I mean, obviously PC gaming is a little more fluid. Yeah. But I don't know.
But yeah, just a side note that I want to touch on for people who are like, oh, well, this works for cell phones because they're, you know, $200 as opposed to $600 for a new console or whatever. Like, assuming that's how much it is.
Not true.
That's not true.
Not anymore.
Like, one, it was technically never true. They, like, just like the $200 phones were subsidized by the carrier. Like, hey, join us for 2 years and we'll give you like a $400 discount on a phone.
Yeah, exactly. Like, if you were now, to buy a phone outright, it would be like a $700-$800 phone.
Yeah. I think like the top of the line iPhones, when they, like, if you don't have a subsidy, they're like $1,000.
Yeah, something like that.
And it's ridiculous. It shouldn't be that much, but like that's just how it is.
Yep.
So like, and now like carriers aren't subsidizing the phones anymore. They're, but like they put you on a payment plan, so it's like, hey, $25 a month for,
yeah, and they
2 years
give you the bullcrap line of like, oh, it's the same cost. It's the same cost. You're paying the same amount for the phone. It's like, excuse me, I used to pay $50 for my iPhone when it went on sale at Target. Like,
yeah, but Ben. You're paying the same. You're actually paying less. You're only paying $25.
Yeah, just, except my cell phone bill continues to go up and up and up.
Yeah. I'm not too worried about, like, I'm not worried about iterative console design where it's like, oh, you have to buy a console every couple of years. That's fine.
I mean, I'm a little worried about it just because, I don't know. I mean, if they keep costs down, I would be okay with it.
Yeah. I like,
but in order for me to feel comfortable purchasing a console outright, because like I can't put my Xbox on a payment plan.
Yeah.
So the only way I would feel comfortable with purchasing one like every 2 or 3 years is if they were only like $250.
Sure. Which anything, obviously is not going to happen.
Yeah. I mean, anything more than that I feel is kind of absurd. Because I mean, even if I take like my monthly payment plan and extrapolate it over 2 years for a phone, like, yeah, I mean, I guess that does kind of come out to be around the same price as dropping, you know, $500-$600 on a video game console. But
I mean, I think that like, because I think it's gonna like each console that you get will last longer than 2 years, because I think that like, I think that Microsoft and Sony are aware that people don't want to upgrade their console that often. So I don't think that they're going to completely screw people out. But like, it's going to be like, you're going to probably start feeling the performance dip at about 2 years, which I mean, is kind of just how consoles work in general. You're kind of like, oh, this is already obsolete by the time it comes out, but that's okay. And then 2 years later, you're like, that's kind of slow. All right.
I mean, I've never really felt that way.
I have felt that way so much lately.
Not, I mean, when it came to the Xbox 360 and, you know, when we hit like the 5, 6, 7 year marks and everything, I was like, this is ridiculous, guys. Like, my phone has better hardware than what is in this box now. Like, that, yes. But like, I've never, 1 or 2 years afterwards, felt like the hardware was obsolete, except for with the Xbox One and the PS4, because they shipped with such drastically gimped hardware.
Yeah. Which I was mostly referring to that. I don't really remember. Like, 360 did a really good job of, like, always improving. Like, the 360 and the PS3, like, the graphics and everything, just, like, teams, like, were able to just get so much out of that.
Yeah.
Halo 4 at the very end of the cycle was a really beautiful game.
Yeah, compared to, what, Halo 3?
Yeah. Like, just the jumps and, like, you know, Gears 1 to Gears 3, even Judgment, like, there's just so, like,
yeah,
they were able to take so much from that.
Yeah.
And it was, like, super interesting to watch. And I'm curious if, like, we're ever going to see that kind of stuff again, or if it is just going to, like...
I mean, we might. Like, if Scorpio came out and it was its own standalone console, and it didn't have to worry about being, you know, fully backwards compatible, then I feel like we could see that again. Because Scorpio is a very, very strong piece of hardware. Mm-hmm. It's obviously still not as strong as high-end gaming PCs, but it's competitive with, you know, mid to low highs.
Yeah.
And that's what Xbox 360 was. Like, it was it was pretty much like a mid to high-range gaming PC when it first came out. So, the fact that Scorpio could potentially be the mid to high-range gaming PC... And that's kind of, I don't know, like, that's why I feel they would be better off, like, in a year or two saying Scorpio exclusive is okay, because most developers, like, they're going to get to a point where they don't want to try to take full advantage of the hardware. And if all that extra hardware is only running at, you know, 60% or whatever, just to make my game render at a higher resolution and maybe with a better frame rate... honestly, Scorpio isn't really worth my money at that point.
Yeah. So the question is if my is the Scorpio going to sell enough to warrant Scorpio exclusives? Like,
I think it could, but only if they do it right. And I think the only way they're going to do it right is if, first of all, they're going to have to get rid of the baseline model of Xbox One altogether. Like, no Xbox One basic. You have the choice between the S and the Scorpio.
Mm-hmm.
And then in a year or two, they need to be like, okay, look, the hardware differences are too great. Like, this game over here is going to be Scorpio exclusive.
Yeah.
And it's going to have to be like a killer game that's going to want people to switch over. And I mean, that sucks for the people that maybe like just this year are buying an Xbox One. But at the same time, like that's no different than somebody buying an Xbox 360 a year before the Xbox One came out.
I mean, I think the difference is that Microsoft has promised time and time again that it's going to be backwards compatible. That like any game released for the Scorpio is going to be released for the Xbox One. And it's possible that the way they get around that is they come out with another console and they're like, this is the, like you said, Scorpio 2. And then that promise is not made for the Xbox One.
Yeah.
Right.
But I mean, but anyway. I just don't see that being a great, like, viable business decision. I mean, unless it is literally like the exact same piece of hardware and they just happen to, like, rename it, throw it inside a new box, and then I mean, I don't know.
Anyways,
like I said, it'll be interesting to watch it all unfold. Yeah. I'm probably not going to be getting one on launch, but that's mainly because I am broke. So,
you know, I probably will not be getting one until the next Gears of War comes out. Is pretty much how I'm going to say that, because I'll probably get a new one for the new Gears of War.
I would like to think that I would get one, you know, within the first year or two, but I don't even really see that unless either A, I fall into a lot of money.
Hey guys,
or B,
share this video with your friends and help us get a bunch of money for a Scorpio.
Yeah.
Ben needs it.
Sure.
Anyway, we're gonna finish things up here. Last thing, pop quiz. What's the name of project? The actual name of Project Scorpio.
What do you mean? Like, what's it gonna be called?
Yeah, go off the top of your head.
I don't know.
Off the top, come on. Anything, just say things.
I don't know. I
come on, man.
Dude, I still call the fucking Switch. Whatever that was called. Damn it. You know what I'm talking about. Like, I reference the Nintendo Switch all the time as the Nintendo NX.
Yeah,
that's okay. What it is. Like, I'll be like, yeah, you know, I was playing the NX the other day, and that was the code name. Like, it has never been called that, and it has not been called that for a very long time now, but I still call it that. So I'm still probably going to be calling Project Scorpio, you know, the Scorpio for a very long time.
So my name is super shitty, and I don't think it's going to happen, but I was, like, reading through the specs, and I was like, oh, this is, like, 4 times as strong as the Xbox One. They're going to call this the Xbox 4. And their tagline is going to be 4 times stronger.
4 times the Xbox.
It's also the fourth Xbox, so, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not a great name, but they also called the Xbox One the Xbox One, so who really knows?
If they're smart, they won't do that. And they will call it, like, Xbox One X or something. Like, have it still be an Xbox One with, like, some other identifier at the end or something, you know? Because...
What if they pull, like, an iPad and they're like, the Xbox?
See, but, you still run into the same problem. Because, I know. You something that people, like, woefully underestimate, and having worked at the call center at Nintendo for a little while, you know, all those years ago... I can tell you that this is a real life problem that people have. If they walk into a store and be like, well, I'm looking at this game and it says, you know, it's for the Xbox. Will that work on my Xbox One? No, it won't. Well, why? Well, because it's for the Xbox, not Xbox One.
To be fair, one of my friends in high school worked at the Best Buy customer service, and they got a call asking if a Nintendo game would work in an Xbox. And it was like, aren't they the same company?
Yep.
So you're going to get stupid people no matter what. But anyway, we're out of time. We are out of time. I'm cutting you off. You're done.
Well, I'm just saying, my point,
you're done.
They have to name it something so that there's no brand confusion.
Sure. The new Xbox.
God, no. Nintendo tried that. It didn't work.
No, Apple tried it too. Kind of worked. It was like the new iPad. They went from like iPad 1, 2, 3, and then the new iPad. It was the dumbest thing I've ever seen.
I never heard that one.
Yeah,
I must have missed it. I know that Nintendo did it with the new Nintendo 3DS.
Oh yeah, that's right. Anyway, we're out of time. Thank you guys for watching. Subscribe so that Ben can afford Scorpio when it comes out. And we'll see you guys next time on Split Couch Games.
Bye. God, I hope it's not called the new Xbox.